And they talked quite articulately about another poll, what demonstrated their capacity to inspire. And here are some of the quotes that we got from them when we asked them about the kind of world they would like to see, what, you know, what the future. The male Jupiter worker, we have rights from the state, we are its citizens, food, shelter, etc., are basic rights. All of these were lost with the closure of the mills. My first and foremost right from the government is the right to a proper job. And of course, we're hearing this in other parts of the world as well. If I had work, I would not have any grievance against anyone. If I could earn, I would meet all my needs. And a female self-employed woman said, a female self-employed woman, female self-employed person, said, we need a society where there will be jobs for the poor. No one wants to beg. Everyone has pride and self-respect. I have nothing. If I had a job, I would not have to beg. And here's a Nijarpuri urban member. If the government evicts us, and this eviction issue was very real and very traumatic for them, it will turn us into homeless people. If we came to be civilized with the constitution, everyone has a fundamental right to decent accommodation. How can the government evict so many people without making alternative arrangements? I have come to the end of my tether. I have no address of my own. If I cannot give an address, even to my children, how can I be a citizen? The question of rights and citizenship is irrelevant in a country which cannot even give me assurance of accommodation. And this another woman said, I want a country in which there will be no discrimination, everybody will live at the same level. If birds and animals can live in a similar way to each other, why can't human beings? After all, they have more brains than animals. So why at the end of the day is there food for some and for others? And what you hear from this is not the language of prisoners. It's not the language of innate deference to authority. It is the language of people who are frustrated by their situation and who can find their own organizational outlet. And that's why the social mobilization organizations have played such an important role. And what you see from the social mobilization organizations is what I thought of as a purposively designed route to citizenship. Because these organizations, by abandoning the idea of service provision, you know, money, finance, or whatever, they can concentrate on building up the collective capabilities of people. And what I saw was a kind of a process through which different, and this is not sequential, but it's these different moments that spark off each other, that interact with each other, and that create kind of momentum for change. What is awareness? And as one woman said, it was as though we were sitting in a room, in a dark room with our eyes closed, until the organization came. Courage. Before we were scared to even talk to a guard, now we know the nature of our fears. Building a collective identity, and this is something that was repeated again and again. One stick can be broken, a bunch of sticks cannot. It is not possible to achieve anything on your own. And this goes back to what we talked about earlier about the power of associations. Exercising voice, and this is very literal, you know, literally. I was never able to speak before, now I can speak. But it is also, I can stand on the stage and I can give speech. I'm just a mechanic, but I can be heard. Struggles around injustice, they have been seen to stand up to injustice, and therefore, these group members have become identified with being on the side of justice. Demanding accountability, and literally I check the union council about what has been allotted to the poor under the social protection programs. The chairman used to just distribute 20 kgs a week by an age of 30. But when we stood to protest this, he's been compelled to distribute quite a lot of meat. And providing political leadership. These people are not cynical about the vote. The vote is a priceless commodity. It is a kind of power. And finally, I wanted to end by saying one of the things that struck me very much in these interviews, and you know, it very much was about communities. It was about moving from the communities of fate, of birth, to communities, chosen communities, and communities of practice. And somewhere in this transition, I picked up a kind of a discussion around different kinds of unpredictability. So moving from bad unpredictability to good unpredictability, and this is what I used. This is an urban microfinance client who says, when it comes to medical treatment, poor people have to buy a ticket in order to stand in the queue to see the doctor. Rich people can just come out of their cars and see the doctor without ever having to buy a ticket. And I may not even get to see the doctor after having bought my ticket, but the rich person can see him anytime. That to me is bad. You do what you're supposed to do, you buy your ticket, you queue up, but there's no guarantees. And the good unpredictability is this man who said, if we were to talk about the strength of Nijarapuri, I would say that in the past, we the poor did not realize many things. My father was a sharecropper. I also became a sharecropper. We thought we would have to pass our days doing the same things as our forefathers did. Those with assets would stay rich, and those without would stay poor. Through Nijarapuri, we came to know we are born poor, the government was wealth. And now when I need help, I do not go to the landlord. But here what I felt was that there was a predictability about people's lives, which was about the status quo. And so what this man was saying, my father as well, sharecropper's grandfather was a sharecropper, I thought that's all I could be as a sharecropper. But now I know that the future is more uncertain, that we can aspire to many other things. So that, I think, is the end of what I want to say. And one of the things that I want, the conclusions that I would draw from this, is that, Bangladesh's governance is getting worse. I don't know if we're going to meet the Transparency International's bottom of this criteria again, but it is getting worse. And I think a sense of hopelessness comes into people. And this is not just poor people, this is middle class people and so on. But for very poor people, middle class people can leave, they can do very well, some things can be right. But for very poor people, it is very clear that without organization, there is very little hope that they will be able to achieve the kind of countervailing force that they need to make these governments more accountable. But it's also clear that they need support on a number of different fronts. And microfinance has provided for many poor people a lifeline. It may not have got them out of poverty, but what they also need are these organizations that are on their side no matter what, that are not there to, see if they can pay their loans on time, or their relatives are dying, or whatever, but are literally on their side in fighting injustice. Now, of course, one could say perhaps organizations like RAC and Grameen Bank should take on more of these social functions, but actually, it is not possible. If you become a microfinance organization and you are driven by financial sustainability, it very often crowds out any other possibility. You may not know this, but BRAC, when it interviews new recruits to its staff, those people with good degrees go into microfinance. And those people with lousy degrees go into social development. Because that's what BRAC thinks are its priorities. So organizations that are driven by microfinance are never going to make it become hybrid and have space for social organization. So what the alternative is to have many other different kinds of social organization. But of course, that is a form of social change that does not fit into the logic of governance. So we are seeing, little by little, the social organization is also disappearing in the case of Bangladesh. Well, that one doesn't look. Thank you.